Hey everybody, Gary here with Pound Music, and in this video we're going to go over Stevie Ray Vaughan's awesome 12-bar solo that you just heard as an intro to Tin Pan Alley with Johnny Copeland live in Montreux 1985. So we're going to go over it phrase by phrase. I'm going to play it slower, mostly because I have to play it slower, and talk about some of the techniques that are at play, how he's approaching each chord, some of the kind of repeat guitar moves that he does over and over, and how we might play them, his sheets of sound raking technique. So even though I made the video, I have a lot left to work on in here to really incorporate it into my own vocabulary. And speaking of that, that's my main goal here, is to help you take these great riffs and incorporate them into your own musical vocabulary. The way I see the process of becoming a more creative player or improviser is as a three-step process of learning great music that you love, understanding the context, which is what my Fret Live animations are to help you do, see how it exists on the fretboard, the intervals, how it relates to the chords, and then workshopping those ideas to make them your own. So you could take any one of Stevie's ideas here that you love and spend an hour just trying to rearrange it, reinterpret it, play it in different areas of the neck, play it slow, play it fast, change the rhythm up, maybe start it the same way, end it a different way. So I'm going to demonstrate a little of that, and then I'll leave a backing track for you at the end to try a little bit on your own for 12 bars. And then if you want to do it for like 12 minutes, I'll link to the backing track video in the description. As always, for Pound Music patrons, I have the downloadable PDF tab or playable tab if you have a tab player like Guitar Pro for everything that Stevie played in that intro, and I've timestamped the riffs in the document as well. And if you really want to go in depth on the study of applied music theory on the guitar, learning the theory and then applying it to make music and learn songs, that's what my Fret Live Fretboard Mastery program is all about. You could take either a self-paced version of that program where it's self-guided through all the content, or you could do a live version with a cohort of 40 other students, weekly live Zoom sessions where we interact on video, and it's much more like a college experience where you get that camaraderie and weekly accountability. So I'll link that in the description along with a video tour of the course where you could hear from students about how it's transformed their playing. And last but not least, you can download two free multi-page full-color PDFs on the diatonic scale shapes and pentatonic scale shapes, and those are also linked in the description. All right, let's get into the lesson. So Tin Pan Alley is an awesome minor blues. It's a 12-8 slow minor blues. So the main voicings in this position, this would be B minor 7. I've also seen Stevie at the 9th. Then the 4 chord, E minor 7. But you could also play E9. You see Johnny Copeland play this chord, and he also adds the 13 with his pinky. Especially on the last line when it goes 5, 4, 1, 4, 1, 5. But it's not going to clash and it's going to sound bluesy. And then F sharp minor 7. Or F sharp 7, sharp 9. And the note sharp 9 is the same note as a minor 3rd. So this chord has both a major 3rd and a minor 3rd. Very bluesy. And then we could also just play a regular F sharp 9. So there's a little flexibility there. If you listen to the organ, you hear the minor chords, but you see Johnny Copeland playing the dominant 9 chords with the major 3rd, and you even see Stevie play an arpeggio riff over the 4 chord with the major 3rd. So that ambiguity with the major 3rd, minor 3rd, even in a minor blues, it works. The reason why you would add that major 3rd on the last chord is because it just provides a little more tension back to the tonic when we go back to the beginning. So here's an example of how I would play it combining some of these voicings. Thank you. mostly I just played the minor seventh chords with just some embellishments. On the four chord, I went from minor seven to the dominant nine. I might have added the 13th like Johnny Copeland. At least I did before the take with my dog, which were better takes, but I thought this one was funnier. And then the last chord, I did the F sharp 7 sharp 9 Hendrix chord. And yeah, so you could just kind of mix those up. All right, so now that we know the chords, let's go over Stevie's solo. So this opening riff is just to set up the song, culminating in the five chord, F sharp minor seven or F sharp seven sharp nine. And he starts with this B minor riff and he plays basically the B minor chord, right? So this is, that's the B minor chord right there. Root, third, fifth. So he slides up from the fourth to the flat five. So that's blues scale, because the blues scale is just the pentatonic scale plus the flat five, right? Plus that half step. So right, so it sounds great in this minor blues. Then he goes, so that time with his pinky, he plays the flat seven, then comes back to that fourth, but this time bends up to the flat five, and then back down to the root, right? Now here he bends up the minor third to a major third. It's a minor chord, but why not? It's such a bluesy thing to do. Then just walks down the blues scale, but does a little trill here. And then, now the way that Stevie grips the guitar is a little different. He's pretty much always this thumb over, index finger planted, like that. I prefer more of the bar as opposed to the thumb over. See what works for you. And he's just hammering on between the flat seven and the root, but he's also hitting this note by just, you know, pulling down on both the strings. So we're getting, right? Yeah, and you see him with his right hand kind of refresh it to get more sustained. So he does something like, you know, he's adding to it again with the right hand. Then he goes, and there, the chord there, it's really, you could see his hand, he's gripping an F sharp, seven sharp nine, often called the Hendrix chord, sharp nine chord. I mean, it's just maybe made famous in songs like, Purple Haze, that was an E, but he doesn't actually play the third. He just plays the fifth and the bass, the minor seventh, and the minor third. Now, as far as fingering goes, like right here on this first riff, I don't know if Stevie's actually using his pinky here. I think what he might be doing is going, using his second finger there and then his third finger here, like that, right? So Stevie was more into index middle ring and would definitely use his pinky on this note. You see that a lot, but he barely ever uses his pinky in the other parts of the scale. Me personally, I am. So some of the fingerings, I tried to do what I thought Stevie would do when I couldn't see it. But others, I might be wrong I feel very confident about all the notes and the rhythms, but I might be wrong about sometimes where I put a pinky. It could be a third finger. Sometimes where I put a third finger, it could be a second finger. So experiment with your fingering and see what works for you. Then we've got the drum roll. So we start here with this. So kind of a slow bend from that fourth up to the fifth. And we're bending to the note that we play next, right? So there's this unison sound. So the thing to work on there is just the tuning of this bend. Get it to match that note and see if you could hold this one out while you play the next one. Then you see him put his thumb over and play that whole chord with the rest of the band. That's when the band kicks in. Now you don't have to hold that note out. You could go, right? That's easier. So if you keep your index finger so that it would mute the G string, when you let go of the G string, it's gonna kill the note. You could also move your palm down on your right hand once you wanna kill the G string. Now Stevie used the kind of fulcrum technique, which is to use the neck as a fulcrum and to take that note and twist it up, right? So he didn't just push with his finger, he used his whole hand. Right, so it's this kind of a motion. And then the index finger and the thumb kind of mute these strings so that nothing rings out. Then we've got. So Stevie loves playing the second scale degree, or the ninth relative to the chord, B minor. That's the ninth. And here he's just taking this kind of triad grip and just doing a pull off with it. And then again, the sliding back and forth between the fourth and the flat five. And then working down to the root. Then that vibrato, then he lets go of it. And when he lets go, we get this double stop. So he kind of pulls off, right? Little detail. Then he just walks right up the blues scale, picking close to the bridge. Get a kind of sharp attack. And then when he gets up to here, then he bends that note, then plays that note not bent, pulls off. Pulls off, then comes down to the root. And then again, this is kind of a motif. He keeps coming back to this. Plays that note. So this note, we're bending to the fifth here from the four to the five. Whereas earlier we were doing to the flat five. Right, so we could bend this one to the five. Or to the flat five. All right, then we come into the House of Blues. Coming in on the root. Then bending that fourth to the fifth. Then come back down to the root. So here, very BB. Right, that BB box. So he's hitting the major sixth. And then kind of working his way back down to the main pattern. So after we got the... Then this is all kind of one note, for me at least, meaning one pick. Classic blues riff here. Earlier when we went here, we do the same thing where we want to bend this note to match that one. So after we go, then we've got so he does the, and then, so first it's down the blues scale, and then to that perfect fifth, not the flat five. So now I think he's doing a lot of slides with the third finger, like that. Okay, let's see what the next part of it is. So I guess we could think of the whole first part as... Now it's always great to try to hum these riffs, because that's... If you really know the vocabulary, you could hum it. I actually find it easier to play if I hum along, because I'm focused more on the sound than the technique. It's almost like I don't get in the way of my hands. Then from there he goes. We've seen that already, right? So he's using a lot of licks we've seen already. Just really fast. Right, so this is all you know. So this. We've seen this already, right? So after, right, you can do something like that. He's doing it probably like this. Then the really fast part, he goes da di a do di a do di a do da di 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 do di 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 do. So he keeps landing on this, but first he starts here. How he's doing it, it's kind of like this raking. Then. To the four chord. So. Right, so it's a collection of kind of classic riffs that he's just playing super fast using kind of this. But the best thing to do is just split it into riffs and workshop each one of these riffs, you know. Like, that's a little idea. So I'm just kind of putting those in a blender. I can't yet play it at lightning speed like him, but I could try just. Then this cool riff. And that's right out of this arpeggio. 1, 3, 5, flat 7, 1. Comes back into the main shape, landing back on the root. Four. Then similar riff. Arpeggio, but then comes back down again. And then that note signifies a return back to the one chord. So that's our return back to the one chord. Slide down from the one downwards, then we get into this cool part. Then we got this cool kind of double stoppy riff. So this part is, this is like a rake riff where the finger motion is holding down the index finger, going on the G string from 7 to 9. Then we've got, and then we've got the 9th fret on the D. Then he does. This is a popular Stevie riff, playing that 9th, then into the House of Blues. So that's playing the blue note, which is right outside the House of Blues. Just one fret up. Like here he did. He's doing it up here. So. Then he slides again into that BB box and plays this G sharp minor 7 chord. So he's playing this chord over the 5. So it's a minor 7. He's playing, instead of F sharp minor 7, he's playing a minor 7 up a whole step, which gives you all the upper extensions of the chord. So this note is the second, or the ninth. This is the 11th. And then this is the root, ninth, 11th root of this chord. So in a sense, he's just playing the upper extensions of that chord, which the band is playing. He's playing the jazzier notes. Chord, and what it ends up sounding like is an E7 sus 2, but he's just playing a B minor, but the bass player is playing the root an octave lower. Then again, this riff. Now this one's a little different. Usually you go, usually in this earlier you heard him go, but here he goes. And then. All right, everybody, I hope you've enjoyed this lesson so far. These videos are completely free on YouTube. I don't have any sponsors here, so the Patreon page is a way for you to show your support for the channel and also to receive a lot of extra goodies as a reward for your support, which includes extended lessons, the tab, playable tab, tab PDFs, live twice weekly, face-to-face guitar hangs where we all get together, learn different songs, talk about different concepts. All levels are welcome. So come join us. Links in the description. Happy playing, and I'll see you in the next lesson. All right, so now I'm gonna leave you 12 bars to take some of these ideas, workshop them on your own, change them up. You could just work on one idea through the whole solo, just see how much you could get out of it, right? So that's how you get it into your vocabulary. You learn the riff, you change it up, you play it slightly differently, you play it really differently, you use it as inspiration, and then it becomes something all your own. So here's 12 bars, but I'll link to the 12-minute backing track video in the description. Before I go, I'd like to extend a huge thank you to the following upper-level POW Music patrons: William Creighton, Andrew Vogel, Chris Watson, David Crawford, Derek Mickle, Don Stringham, Donald James Grass, Jake Martin, John Cushman, Joseph McCarthy, Kent Grissom, Lemuel Faustin, Michael Varney, Randy Wallingford, Sam Juans, Scott Lee, Sean Ellis, Stephen Pisano, Trampas Thompson. Thank you guys so much, and thank you to all of the POW Music patrons that help make this content possible. Happy playing. I'll see you guys next time.